أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي إلى الأذقان فهم مقمحون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فأغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون إنما تنذر من اتبع الذكر خشي الرحمن بالغيب فبشره بمغفرة وأجر كريم إنا نحن نحيي الموتى ونكتب ما قدموا وآثارهم وكل شيء أحصيناه في إمام مبين واضرب لهم مثلا أصحاب القرية إذ جاءها المرسلون إذ أرسلنا إليهم اثنين فكذبوهما فعززنا بثالث فقالوا إنا إليكم مرسلون قالوا ما أنتم إلا بشر مثلنا وما أنزل الرحمن من شيء إن أنتم إلا تكذبون قالوا ربنا يعلم إنا إليكم لمرسلون وما علينا إلا البلاغ المبين قالوا إنا تطيرنا بكم لئن لم تنتهوا لنرجمنكم وليمسنكم منا عذاب أليم قالوا طائركم معكم فإن ذكرتم بل أنتم قوم مسرفون وجاء من أقصى المدينة رجل يسعى قال يا قوم اتبعوا المرسلين اتبعوا من لا يسألكم أجرا وهم مهتدون وما لي لا أعبد الذي فطرني وإليه ترجعون فأتخذ من دونه آلهة إن يردني الرحمن بضر لا تغني عني شفاعتهم شيئا ولا ينقذون إني إذا لفي ضلال مبين إني آمنت بربكم فاسمعون قيل ادخل الجنة قال يا ليت قومي يعلمون بما غفر لي ربي وجعلني من المكرمين وما أنزلنا على قومه من بعده من جند من السماء وما كنا منزلين إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم خامدون يا حسرة على العباد ما يأتيهم من رسول إلا كانوا به يستهزئون ألم يروا كم أهلكنا قبلهم من القرون أنهم إليهم لا يرجعون وإن كل لما جميع لدينا محضرون وآية لهم الأرض الميتة أحييناها وأخرجنا منها حبا فمنه يأكلون وجعلنا فيها جنات من نخيل وأعناب فجرنا فيها من العيون يأكلوا من ثمره وما عملته أيديهم أفلا يشكرون سبحان الذي خلق الأزواج كلها مما تنبت الأرض ومن أنفسهم ومما لا يعلمون وآية لهم الليل نسلخ منه النهار فإذا هم مظلمون والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر على الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون وآية لهم أنا حملنا ذريتهم في الفلك المشحون فخلقنا لهم من مثله ما يركبون وإن نشأ نغرقهم فلا صريخ لهم ولا هم ينقذون إلا رحمة منا ومتاعا إلى حين وإذا قيل لهم اتقوا ما بين أيديكم وما خلفكم لعلكم ترحمون وما تأتيهم من آية من آيات ربهم إلا كانوا عنها معرضين وإذا قيل لهم أنفقوا مما رزقكم الله قال الذين كفروا للذين آمنوا أنطعم من لو يشاء الله أطعمه إن أنتم إلا في ضلال مبين ويقولون متى هذا الوعد إن كنتم صادقين ما ينظرون إلا صيحة واحدة تأخذهم وهم يخصمون فلا يستطيعون توصية ولا إلى أهلهم يرجعون فنفخ في الصور فإذا هم من الأجداث إلى ربهم ينسلون قالوا يا ويلنا من بعثنا من مرقدنا هذا ما وعد الرحمن وصدق المرسلون إن كانت إلا صيحة واحدة فإذا هم جميع لدينا محضرون فاليوم لا تظلم نفس شيئا ولا تجزون إلا ما كنتم تعملون إن أصحاب الجنة اليوم في شغل فاكهون هم أزواجهم في ظلال على الأرائك متكئون لهم فيها فاكهة ولهم ما يدعون سلام قولا من رب رحيم وامتاز اليوم أيها المجرمون ألم أعهد إليكم يا بني آدم ألا تعبدوا الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين وأن اعبدوني هذا صراط مستقيم ولقد أضل منكم جبلا كثيرا أفلم تكونوا تعقلون هذه جهنم التي كنتم توعدون اصلوها اليوم بما كنتم تكفرون اليوم نختم على أفواههم وتكلمنا أيديهم وتشهد أرجلهم بما كانوا يكسبون ولو نشاء لطمسنا على أعينهم فاستبقوا الصراط فأنى يبصرون ولو نشاء لمسخناهم على مكانتهم فما استطاعوا مضيا ولا يرجعون ومن نعمره ننكسه في الخلق أفلا يعقلون وما علمناه الشعر ما ينبغي له إن هو إلا ذكر وقرآن مبين ينذر من كان حيا ويحق القول على الكافرين أولم يروا أنا خلقنا لهم مما عملت أيدينا أنعاما فهم لها مالكون وذللناها لهم فمنها ركوبهم ومنها يأكلون ولهم فيها منافع ومشارب أفلا يشكرون واتخذوا من دون الله آلهة لعلهم ينصرون لا يستطيعون نصرهم وهم لهم جند محضرون فلا يحزنك قولهم إنا نعلم ما يسرون وما يعلنون أولم يرى الإنسان أنا خلقناه من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين وضرب لنا مثلا ونسي خلقه قال من يحيي العظام وهي رميم قل يحييها الذي أنشأها أول مرة وهو بكل خلق عليم الذي جعل لكم من الشجر الأخضر نارا فإذا أنتم منه توقدون أليس الذي خلق السماوات والأرض بقادر على أن يخلق مثلهم بلى وهو الخلاق العليم إنما أمره إذا أراد شيئا أن يقول له كن فيكون فسبحان الذي بيده ملكوت كل شيء وإليه ترجعون صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم رب شهر رمضان الذي أنزلت فيه القرآن وافترضت على عبادك فيه الصيام صل على محمد وآل محمد وارزقني حج بيتك الحرام في عامي هذا وفي كل عام واغفر لي تلك الذنوب العظام فإنه لا يغفرها غيرك يا رحمن يا علام اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم إني أفتتح الثناء بحمدك وأنت مصدد للصواب بمنك وأيقنت أنك أنت أرحم الراحمين في موضع العفو والرحمة وأشد المعاقبين في موضع النكال والنقمة وأعظم المتجبرين في موضع الكبرياء والعظمة اللهم أذنت لي في دعائك ومسألتك فاسمع يا سميع مدحتي وأجب يا رحيم دعوتي وأقل يا غفور عثرتي فكم يا إلهي من قربة قد فرجتها وهموم قد كشفتها وعثرة قد عقلتها ورحمة قد نشرتها وحلقة بلاء قد فككتها. الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ صاحبة ولا ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل فكبره تكبيرا. الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر. الحمد لله بجميع محامده كلها على جميع نعمه كلها. الحمد لله الذي لا مضاد له في ملكي ولا منازع له في أمري. الحمد لله الذي لا شريك له في خلقي ولا شبيه له في عظمتي. الحمد لله الفاشي في الخلق أمره وحمده، الظاهر بالكرم مجده، الباسط بالجود يداه، الذي لا تنقص خزائنه ولا تزيده كثرة العطاء إلا جودا وكرما، إنه هو العزيز الوهاب. اللهم إني أسألك قليلا من كثير، ما حاجات بي إليه عظيمة، وغناك عنه قديم، وهو عندي كثير، وهو عليك سهل يسير. اللهم إنا عفوك عن ذنبي، وتجاوزك عن خطيئتي، وصفحك عن ظلمي، وسترك على قبيح عملي، وحلمك عن كثير جرمي، عندما كان من خطئي وعمدي، أطمعني في أن أسألك ما لا أستوجبه منك، الذي رزقتني من رحمتك، وأريتني من قدرتك، وأرفتني من إجابتك، فصرت أدعوك آمنا وأسألك مستأنسا، لا خائفا ولا وجلا، مدلا عليك فيما قصدت فيه إليك، فإن أبطى عني عتبت بجهل عليك، ولعل الذي أبطى عني هو خير لي لعلمك بعاقبة الأمور. فلم أر مولا كريما أصبر على عبد لئيم منك عليك. يا رب إنك تدعوني فأولي عنك، وتتحبب إلي فأتبغض إليك، وتتودد إلي فلا أقبل منك، كأن لي التطول عليك فلم يمنعك ذلك من الرحمة لي والإحسان إليك والتفضل عليك بجودك وكرمك. فارحم عبدك الجاهل وجد عليه بفضل إحسانك، إنك جواد كريم. الحمد لله مالك الملك، مجري الفلك، مسخر الرياح، فالق الإصباح، ديان الدين، رب العالمين. الحمد لله على حلمه بعد علمي، والحمد لله على عفوه بعد قدرتي، والحمد لله على طول أناته في غضبي، وهو قادر على ما يريد. الحمد لله خالق الخلق، باسط الرزق، فالق الإصباح، ذي الجلال والإكرام، والفضل والإنعام، الذي بود فلا يرى، وقرب فشهد النجوى، تبارك وتعالى. الحمد لله الذي ليس له منازع يعادله، ولا شبيه يشاكله، ولا ظهير يعاضده، قهر بعزته الأعزة، وتواضع لعظمته العظمى، وبلغ بقدرته ما يشاء. الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أنادي، ويستر علي كل عورة وأنا أعصي، ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازي، فكم من موهبة هنيئة قد أعطاني، وعظيمة مخوفة قد كفاني، وبهجة مولقة قد أراني، فأثني عليه حامدا، وأذكره مسبحا. الحمد لله الذي لا يحتك حجابه، ولا يغلق بابه، ولا يرد سائله، ولا يخيب آمله. الحمد لله الذي يؤمن الخائفين، وينجي الصالحين ويرفع المستضعفين ويضع المستكبرين ويهلك ملوكا ويستخلف آخرين. والحمد لله قاسم الجبارين مبير الظالمين مدرك الهاربين نكال الظالمين صريخ المستصرخين موضي حاجات الطالبين معتمد المؤمنين. الحمد لله الذي من خشيته ترعد السماء وسكانها وترجف الأرض وعمارها وتموج البحار ومن يشبه في غمراتها. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله الذي يخلق ولم يخلق ويرزق ولا يرزق ويطعم ولا يطعم ويميت الأحياء ويحيي الموتى وهو حي لا يموت بيده الخير وهو على كل شيء قدير. اللهم صل على محمد عبدك ورسولك وأمينك وصفيك وحبيبك وخيرتك من خلقك وحافظ سرك من مبلغ رسالتك أفضل وأحسن وأجمل وأكمل وأزكى وأنمى وأطيب وأطهر وأسنى وأكثر ما صليت باركت وترحمت تحننت وسلمت على أحد من عبادك وأنبيائك ورسلك وصفوتك وأهل الكرامة عليك من خلقك. اللهم صل على علي أمير المؤمنين وصي رسول رب العالمين عبدك وليك وأخي رسولك وحجتك على خلقك وآيتك الكبرى والنبأ العظيم. وصل على صديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين. وصل على سبط الرحمة وإمام الهدى الحسن والحسين سيدي شباب أهل الجنة. وصل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي. حججك على عبادك وأمنائك في بلادك صلاة كثيرة دائمة. اللهم صل على ولي أمرك القائم المؤمل والعدل المنتظر وحفه بملائكتك المقربين وأيده بروح القدس يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعله الداعي إلى كتابك والقائم بدينك استخلفه في الأرض كما استخلفت الذين من قبله. مكن له دينه الذي ارتضيته له أبدله من بعد خوفه أمنا يعبدك لا يشرك بك شيئا. اللهم عزه وعزز به وانصره وانتصر به وانصره نصرا عزيزا وافتح له فتحا يسيرا واجعل له من لدنك سلطانا نصيرا. اللهم أظهر به دينك وسنة نبيك حتى لا يستخفي بشيء من الحق مخافة أحد من الخالق. اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهله وتذل بها النفاق وأهله وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم ما عرفتنا من الحق فحملنا وما قصرنا عنه فبلغنا. اللهم المن به شعثنا واشعب به صدعنا وارتق به فتقنا وكثر به قلتنا وأعزز به ذلتنا وأغن به عائلنا واقض به عن مغرمنا واجبر به فقرنا وصد به خلتنا ويسر به عسرنا وبيض به وجوهنا وفك به أسرنا وأنجح به طلبتنا وأنجز به مواعيدنا واستجب به دعوتنا وأعطنا به سؤلنا وبلغنا به من الدنيا والآخرة آمالنا وأعطنا به فوق رغبتنا يا خير المسؤولين وأوسع المعطين اشف به صدورنا وأذهب به غيظ قلوبنا واهدنا به لما اختلف فيه من الحق بإذنك إنك تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم وانصرنا به على عدوك وعدونا إلى الحق آمين. اللهم إنا نشكو إليك فقد نبينا صلواتك عليه وآله وغيبة ولينا وكثرة عدونا وقلة عددنا وشدة الفتن بنا وتظاهر الزمان علينا وصل على محمد وآل محمد وعنا على ذلك بفتح منك تؤجله وبضر تكشفه ونصر تعزه وسلطان حق تظهره ورحمة منك تجللناها وعافية منك تلبسناها برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم برحمتك في الصالحين فأدخلنا وفي عليين فارفعنا وبكأس من معين من عيل سلسبيل فاسقنا ومن الحور العين برحمتك فزوجنا ومن الولدان المخلدين كأنهم لؤلؤ مكنون فأخدمنا ومن ثمار الجنة ولحوم الطير فأطعمنا ومن ثياب السندس والحرير والاستبرق فألبسنا وليلة القدر وحج بيتك الحرام وقتلا في سبيلك فوفق لنا وصالح الدعاء والمسألة فاستجب لنا وإذا جمعت الأولين والآخرين يوم القيامة فارحمنا وبراءة من النار فاكتب لنا وفي جهنم فلا تغلنا وفي عذابك وهوانك فلا تبتلنا ومن الزقوم والضريع فلا تطعمنا ومع الشياطين فلا تجعلنا وفي النار على وجوهنا فلا تكببنا ومن ثياب النار وسرابيل القطران فلا تلبسنا ومن كل سوء يا لا إله إلا أنت بحق لا إله إلا أنت فنجنا. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم إني أسألك أن تجعل فيما تقضي وتقدر من الأمر المحتوم بالأمر الحكيم من القضاء الذي لا يرد ولا يبدل أن تكتبني من حجاج بيتك الحرام المبرور حجهم المشكور سعيهم المغفور ذنوبهم المكفر عن سيئاتهم وأن تجعل فيما تقضي وتقدر أن تطيل عمري في خير وعافية وتوصي في رزقي وتجعلني ممن تنتصر به لدينك ولا تستبدل بي غيري. أعوذ بجلال وجهك الكريم أن ينقضي عني شهر رمضان أو يطلو الفجر من ليلتي هذه ولك قبل تبع أو ذنب تعذبني عليه. إلهي وقف السائلون ببابك ولا ذا الفقراء بجنابك وقف السفينة المساكين على ساحل بحر جودك وكرمك يرجون الجواز إلى ساحة رحمتك ونعمتك إلهي إن كنت لا ترحم في هذا الشهر الشريف إلا من إلا لمن أخلص لك في صيامه وقيامه، فمن للمذنب المقصر إذا غرق في بحر ذنوبه وآثامه. إلهي إن كنت لا ترحم إلا للمطيعين، فمن للعاصين؟ وإن كنت لا تقبل إلا من العاملين، فمن للمقصرين؟ إلهي ربح الصائمون، وفاز القائمون، ونجا المخلصون، ونحن عبيدك المذنبون. فارحمنا برحمتك، وأعتقنا من النار بعفوك، واغفر لنا ذنوبنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
Once again, Suratul Mubarakatul Fatiha for all our marhumin and marhumin of all mu'minin and mu'minat. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya kana. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدنا وحبيبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم محمد، اللهم صل على محمد، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا، اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. My dear brothers and sisters who are watching, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah. One of the verses of the Holy Quran, normally when we discuss about the issue of marriage, we recite the ayah in Surah Ar-Rum. Surah Ar-Rum, Surah number 30, ayah number 21, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wa min ayatihi an khalaqa lakum min anfusikum azwajan litaskunu ilayha wa ja'ala baynakum mawaddatan wa rahma. Inna fi dhalika la ayatin liqawmi yatafakkaroon. This ayah, almost every maulana, when they recite nikah, they take this ayah as a guideline to talk about the issues which are regarding to marriage. And indeed, the ayah is one of those very important verses to be mentioned at the time of nikah, at the time of aqd, at the time of wedding, because it has got a lot of meanings within in it. So ayah 21. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa min ayatihi, one of his signs. There are many signs of Allah. Signs of Allah, those which we know. Signs of Allah, those which we do not know. Signs of Allah, which we pass by, but we don't recognize that these are the signs of Allah. So there are many within yourselves, within your bodies, within our creation, within the horizons. There are many signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In ayah number 21 of Surah Ar-Rum, it says, wa min ayatihi, and one of his signs. So there are many. What is this sign which he mentions here? An khalaqa lakum. He created for you. The address here is for you, men. He created for you. Khalaqa lakum min anfusikum. From the same type of you. From the same gene. From the same creation. Allah created for you. Min anfusikum azwaja. He created for you mates. He created for you women to be your wives. Here by itself, there is a miracle in terms of creation. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to say that, oh men, remember, your wives are not from angels type. They are not from jinn type. They are not animals type. They are human beings like yourselves. So it's easy for us to communicate. Imagine if your wife was an angel, communication would be difficult. An angel can do a lot. You cannot. Angels do not eat. You have to eat. They don't drink. You have. They don't get tired the way we get tired. We do. So Allah, out of his mercy and the creation, he created for us women from the same genes. So they are human beings like us. Allah says, wa min ayatihi an khalaqa lakum min anfusikum azwaja. Why? Litaskunu ilayha. In order for you to get sakina. What is the meaning of sakina? Peace. Tranquility. You can get it from them. So, in other words, if we find some crazy people, they say, for example, they want to marry animals. Yeah, they go for that. These people will tell them that you will not find sakina in them. They want to marry something which is not a human being. You say there is no sakina there, because Allah says, litaskunu ilayha. In order for you to get sakina, Allah created women to be your wives. There is sakina there. Now, sakina also may come not only that you as a human being, you want to be in a proximity with another human being. Not only that, also communication. You communicate easily. Imam Amirul Mu'minin Ali bin Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Muhammad. He says, mal insanu illa bil lisan. Aw al insan, the meaning of the hadith, he says, a human being would not be a human being without the tongue, which he expresses things. Look at the animals. Sometimes we look at them, they're so beautiful. You look at, for example, horse. The way Allah created a horse, you look from top to bottom. You enjoy to look at this animal. Fihi jamalu, aw fiha jamalun. Allah says in Surah Ar-Rum, Surah Ar-Ra'd, if I'm not wrong, or Surah An-Nahl. He says there's beauty within these animals. You look at them, you enjoy them. But they are not to be married. You marry a woman, that's the one which you need to get to. So that's why there's no any discussion. If a man, for example, wants to marry something which is not a human being, there's no any such a discussion within Islam. Litaskunu ilayha, in order for you to find peace and tranquility, marry a woman. And not only that, Allah says, waja'ala bainakum mawaddatan wa rahma. Allah has placed between a husband and a wife, after you get married, Allah has placed two things, mawadda, love, wa rahma, and mercy. Mawadda, compassion. Rahma, mercy. Subhanallah, creation of Allah. You come from a different family. She comes from a different family. You don't know one another. You have not met before, maybe. Maybe your parents organized this marriage to happen. It's difficult to live with someone you don't know. But out of mercy of Allah, He says, there will be rahmah and there will be mercy, there will be mawadda when you live together as husband and wife. So now, once we come to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً, He finishes the ayah, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمٍ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ, indeed in this, whatever has been mentioned in this ayah, لَآيَاتٍ, there are many other signs of Allah, just within what he mentioned. There are many other signs, لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, for those people who think properly, for those people who reflect. Some scholars say, if you find someone, man or woman, who says, I don't want to get married, I will not marry, he has the ability, but he doesn't go for that, then there is an issue there. What is the issue? لَا يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, they don't think properly. If you think properly, you will never say, I'm not going to marry. And that's why when we attend the ceremonies, wedding ceremonies, and we hear the lecture from scholar, he will say that this zawaj and nikah is shi'arul atqiya, aw shi'arul awliya wa fi'alul atqiya. It is a symbol of noble people. And it is a sign of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now, after mentioning this, what we want to discuss is the challenges which we find when we get married, or when we just about to get married. There are many challenges, and we need to discuss about these challenges. Let us establish one thing which has been established within Islam. In Islam, you cannot be a pious person. You cannot say, I want to practice this taqwa in order for me to be closer to Allah, in order for me to be there, I don't want to get married. In order for me to be a muttaqi, the pious person, it's better for me not to marry. No. In Islam, you can't go that way. Wa alaykum as-salam. La rahbaniyata fil Islam. There is no celibacy in Islam. There is no a way for you to say that in order for me to be like wali of awliyaullah, if I get married, then that will stop me to be a person who has taqwa, so I will stop. And actually, it happened at the lifetime of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. One of the sahabiyat, one of the sisters, one of the ladies among the sahabas, she went to complain to the Holy Prophet. Ya Rasulallah, my husband doesn't come closer to me. My husband has deserted me. My husband has forsaken me. Why? The lady say, because he says he has to observe fasting during the day. And during the night, he goes for Salatul Layl. And not only that, he said he will not go to eat meat. He has become vegetarian. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam came out of his house. He was dragging his clothing. When they say that, this is the expression to say that he was not ready, even prepared to come out. Because of what he had, he has to drag his clothing, come out. And he climbed the main pulpit of the Holy Prophet. His house actually was just, you come out of the house, you enter the masjid. Yeah, this is the door, you enter the masjid of Rasulullah. He climbed the minbar and he said, what is this which I hear from you? Some of you, you say you will not go near your wives. Some of you, you say you want to become pious people because you want to pray and fast. Some of you, you said you are not going to eat meat. What is this which I hear from you? I am the messenger of Allah. I sometimes observe fasting, mustahabat. Wajib fasting, Shahru Ramadan, is wajib. Sometimes I observe fasting. Sometimes I eat meat. Sometimes I don't. But what is this which I hear from you? I have wives, wives of the Holy Prophet, more than four, nine or more. What is this which I hear from you? I am the messenger of Allah, and I do what you want to stop yourselves not to do. So he acts that. Now, when we come to know that, we come also to know that there is hadith which has been narrated from him, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Where he says, ma buniya fil islami bina'un. There is no any building which has been built in Islam, which is dearer and so beloved in the eyes of Allah, like a zawaj, like getting married. The getting married is a bina, is a building which has never, you have never seen any building like that. And that's why our scholars say this is an institution. Institution, marriage is an institution. This institution, in order for you to enter it, you know that you should know that it is more holier and more dearer than anything which has been built as a building in Islam. So now when we come to know all this, also we know that it is the sunnah. Marriage is a nikah, is a sunnah of the Holy Prophet and the sunnah of all the awliya of Allah. Anyone who rejects it, he will not be with the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We find that there are some challenges. Those who are married, you know. Those who are not, you need to be aware. Number one, finding the right one. Finding the right one. Who is the right one? Sisters may say, Mr. Right. Yeah, brothers say, Miss Right. Yeah, the right one. To find that, especially in these days, we say these days is difficult. You talk to our fathers, they say their days it was difficult. Maybe their fathers, our grandfathers, they would say their days was difficult. For our children also, maybe it will be difficult. So what can we do? We have to apply the points which have been laid down by the religion of Islam. So number one, to find the right person. Why? Because sometimes you may think that this is the right person I'm going to get married to. Once you get married, you start regretting. I wish I wouldn't marry this. Why? Because of the things which you have seen there. Things become clear. And unfortunately, sometimes when you, for example, in some communities where you are allowed to meet with your wife to be or husband to be, they meetings and going out halal, no, not to haram anything, haram, you come to know that there is the time which someone wants to hide himself or herself properly for you not to recognize the other party. After the marriage, oh, I didn't know you are like this. She says also, I didn't know that you are like this. So the biggest challenge is to find the right person. But in Arabic proverb, it says, man talaba akhan min ghayri aibin baqiya bila akhin. Anyone who is searching for a brother to make this particular individual as your brother, and you want him to be without any defaults, any deficiency, you will remain without any brother. If you want to find Mr. Perfect, there's nothing wrong there. You will remain alone. And that's why the eighth Imam, Ali ibn Musa Ridha, salawatullahi wa salam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. He says always, may Allah have mercy on that individual who, when he sees my shortcomings, he informs me. Meaning what? We have shortcomings. We have faults. Don't find my faults. And even some Arabs, they have mentioned one particular line which is very good. He says, remember, when you with your two eyes you want to find faults from other people, know that people have got many eyes than yours. You just have two. They have many. If they team up together, they can find a lot of faults. So when we talk about husband and wife, we come to know that there are sometimes faults. Sometimes we didn't know. Sometimes these faults may come after you get married. So to find Mr. Perfect, Miss Perfect, sometimes it's not easy. We are human beings and we are not masumin. Challenge number one. Number two, when you say, I want to find the one who is right, what do you mean by right? Right in terms of religion, right in terms of the body you look at, right for what? So that's another box. Sometimes when they tick, you need to look at it closely. What do you mean by right? Now, we understand definitely Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Muhammad, has said, when you get married, shaitan makes a loud noise to say, wa waila, wa waila, wa waila. Meaning what? I have missed him. I have missed him. I have missed him. I have missed her. Who be to me? I have missed this particular individual. Why? Because you have entered in an institution which is secure. So now, once we know that, other challenges come here. When you get married, why do you get married? Each and every one of us has got his own reason. Our Habib, beloved messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, has made it very clear. When someone wants to get married, sometimes you get married because of beauty of this woman. Or if it's a woman, you get married because he's handsome. Number two, because of wealth. Number three, because of family ties. Number four, because of faith, religion, iman. The Holy Prophet says, go for iman. Faith, your hands will be blessed. Go for iman. Someone, especially young people, sometimes they say, no, iman is not enough. I want to see this beautiful creation of Allah so that I can stay with. The understanding is that, remember, the one you are looking at her now to be so beautiful, after she gives birth, and after a few years, that beauty will fade. Will you stay with that woman because now the beauty has disappeared? Or will you divorce and marry another woman? The Holy Prophet says, remember that. Family, you are marrying this individual. You are not marrying the family. You are going to live with this individual. You are not going to live with the family. It's the individual you need. Wealth. Wealth today may be there. Tomorrow may disappear. I think I mentioned here in this particular place that I know a particular individual. Once we were in Africa, in Kenya, and some brothers were showing to me someone. They said he was the richest person in Somalia at the time of Siad Barre. Siad Barre was that president. After he was toppled, problems happened in Somalia. War started, civil. War. Siad Barre was toppled. This particular individual had to leave the country. He used to have many, many lorries for transport business in Somalia. It was for him. So now came war. Would he save himself or would he save those lorries? He had to leave each and everything. He had to run to Kenya. Now he doesn't have even motorbike. Even a motorbike is not there. Everything was left there. When we talk about wealth, wealth can come and go. Rasulullah says, when you marry for the issue of wealth, remember, wealth may come and wealth may disappear. A clear example, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married Khadija, the wealthiest woman in Arab. This noble lady gave each and everything to Rasulullah. And then what happened? She died when they were at Sheba bi Talib. Khadija did not have even a mattress to sleep on. Salamullahi alayhi. But she never complained to Rasulullah, why you brought me at this level? Never. And this woman will remain to be a noble lady. Salamullahi alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. So Rasulullah says, if you are to marry, make sure you marry someone who has got faith. Faith, both men and women. Faith is important. But see the biggest challenge what we have today. When someone wants to marry, we want to know, does he have status? Number one. Yeah. Does he have papers? Yeah, well, it's a good thing, but it's not the highest criteria. Yeah. Does he have qualifications? Does he have a house? Does he have a mortgage? Does he have a degree? And so on and so forth. We put things on top of one another until those themselves, they become challenged to us. And now what if they ask, does she have this? Does she have that? Does she have that? And then it becomes difficult for us. But to us, it is a challenge which we find. And each and every one of us, we need to find a way how to can we solve this particular issue. Now, after these challenges, there's another challenge, which for the Holy Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. He didn't mention it as a challenge, but we are making it as a challenge. And it's one of the biggest challenges which we have today. What is that? Mahar. Dowry. Very expensive one. We make dowry as if there's no big dowry, there's no any marriage. Don't talk to me if there's no big marriage. And the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his hadith, he says, khayru sadaqi aysaruhu. Khayr, better. As-sadaqi, mahar, dowry, aysaruhu is the simple one, little. Don't make it too big until the time comes when people now cannot get married. Why? Because the mahar is too big. Once I was in Holland, we went to give lectures there. And we were talking to these young men who were there. We said, what are the issues here? They said, one of the issues here, Maulana, if you can talk to young people, and especially to the parents, ask them to drop the mahar. It's too big. When one gets married, he has to work hard in order for him to fulfill whatever promises he has given in terms of mahar. And then the expectations after the marriage, when the expectations go down, this particular individual who paid a lot of mahar says, why did I pay all the mahar while what I expected, I can't see it with you. And because of that, many, many proposals are breaking up. Because why? The biggest thing is mahar. It's unfortunate. Well, I don't know. I don't know why. Sometimes you can see within some community, they say, in order for you to marry my daughter, I need a house. You have to make sure there's a mortgage here. I can't afford. Sorry, there's no marriage. We want this amount of money. Big sum. Without this, no. Why? Because we are this community. We, this community, we have to have a lot of money. And so on and so forth. Subhanallah. We have made the religion to be very difficult until our daughters don't get married. When they don't get married, problems and difficulties come. Difficulties come. Why? Because the reason is us. Rasulullah, remember this hadith? Khayru sadaqi aysaruhu. The best mahar is the one which is easy, simple. Alhamdulillah, they are those nice people, mashallah. You ask about the dowry, they say 786, 1110, 114. These numbers, yeah, they connect them. They say, yeah, that's what we want. Alhamdulillah. But now a challenge is here. When you talk to some parents, they say, you know what? We took care of this young girl. We spent a lot of whatever Allah has given us. This young man wants to marry to our daughter. Can we give our daughter easily just like that? So they say, we have to make some, I don't know whether we can call it, some returns of what you have taken care about this girl. No, you cannot compare anything. But they say, yes, we have. Mahar is for the girl. Mahar is not for the father. Mahar is not for the mother. Mahar is not for the brothers or sisters or aunties or uncle. Mahar is for that particular girl. But some parents say that, well, this girl is not experienced. She doesn't know even how to give good sums. So we have to interfere. However, to be fair, mahar in the Holy Quran, Allah has mentioned the word kintara. Kintara, it could be, for our sake of understanding, It could be 1 pound. It could be 10,000. It could be 100,000. It could be million. There is a negotiation. But the Holy Prophet says, خَيْرُ الصَّدَاقِ أَيْسَارُهُ. The best dowry is the one which is little. Now, alhamdulillah, young people, they get opportunity, they marry. One of the challenges which comes after the marriage, the challenge which comes after the marriage is the issue of patience and perseverance. Sometimes our sisters are so hasty, they want particular things to happen within short period of a time. Mama, be patient. Rome was not built in one day. Whatever you want, it will come. And we are together in this marriage. But some of them, they don't have that patience. Some brothers too, they have that problem. The biggest challenge is when the patience is lost. Then nothing can stand properly because one looks at after some gains. If we don't get them, khalas, we are about to break this marriage. And another problem or challenge which we have is the lifestyle. This is the biggest challenge also. Where you are used to a particular lifestyle. Your wife-to-be or wife now you have married is used to a particular lifestyle. You come to live together. How can you reconcile between the two? Here needs a lot in terms of discussion. In Islam, brothers, especially brothers, Islam says when you marry a woman who is your kuf. The word in Arabic, kuf or kufun, your standard. Standard. If you marry someone who is so rich, very rich than you, you may not meet the standard. And sometimes when you marry someone who is too poor, the standard may not be there. There may be difficulties, issues in terms of how you live together. So go for the standard. Kuf is very important. Is it allowed for someone to marry someone who is not his standard? Yes, you can. But be aware. Problems may happen. So get ready. These are challenges. If you are ready to face the challenges, go for that. That's no problem. Another biggest challenge which we find after the marriage is the interference from the parents. Interference from the family members. We can say, according to some of our colleagues, when we discuss about this issue, they say about 80% of the marriages which are broken down, the biggest reason is the interference from the parents. I'm sorry to say this, especially mothers. Why mothers? Because mothers, they look at you, young man, that you are still that baby. They don't trust that you are now can stand on your own. So when they see your wife is demanding from you, they think that, no, she's going to fleece you. Yeah? Where is it going? Whatever I'm giving my wife, it comes back. But mothers don't see it that way. My mother may see that, no. My son suffers. This woman caused trouble to my son. But mama, this is your daughter-in-law. Fathers, at least, they are not like that. But it is a challenge which we see it. And other times, walaikum assalam, those aunties who are there and uncles also, but aunties especially, they come and look at you, subhanallah. When you got married, you used to be, mashallah, you had that nurani face. What's happening these days? You don't sleep properly. We can see you are not even relaxed. And they pump you with words. And sometimes you go there, you bust. Problems happen between you and your wife. Outside interference. And sometimes you have your friends. These friends too. They can say a few things. And if you listen to them, you don't digest properly, then it may cause trouble. So these challenges we find there, and we need to be aware of these challenges. How can we get rid of these challenges? Remember what the Holy Prophet said? Go for the one who has got faith. Because if both of you have faith, then you can stand together. You can say that, no, according to the Holy Quran, this is not right. According to the Hadith, this is not right. According to the life of Rasulullah and Masumina, what they say is not right. You stand together, you team up together. And that's very important. But unfortunately, the biggest problem which we face before we enter into marriage is the issue of dating. Yeah, we go for dating, matchmaking, and so on and so forth. Sometimes, alhamdulillah, we find the people who organize these, whatever you call them, the matchmakers, dating companies, halal dating, and so on and so forth, they follow Islamic etiquettes. So they make sure that they take you to the right place. But some other times, no. Matchmakers, they just want to make money. It's a business. So they don't worry about Islamic etiquettes at all. They worry about your security and our security. You have to be in a right channel, right track. No one can attack you. That's it. But is there an Islamic guidance there? Sometimes we don't see it. So that's another problem which makes us, when we enter into the institution of marriage, we see that there are many challenges and it's not easy for us to get out of these challenges easily. Finally, brothers and sisters, who you are, you the ones who are married, remember, sometimes when you enter into these institutions, you may not get children easily. Or you may not get children at all. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned this clearly. Yahabu liman yasha'u inatha. Wa yahabu liman yasha'u dhukur. Aw yuzawijuhum dhukuranan wa inatha wa yaj'alu liman yasha'u aqima. Allah may bestow upon you baby girls. Alaykum as-salam. And he may bestow upon you baby boys. Or he may decide to bestow upon you both baby girls and baby boys. And other times he may decide not to give you any baby. How are you going to behave? Here you need patience. Here you need understanding. Don't blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why me? Why me? Why not me? Why others? No, Allah knows best. There are few things he may give us here in this dunya. And there are other things he may give us in akhirah. When you do your dua, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana wa qina adhabannar. Have that bigger understanding of what is hasana. Your children could be hasana. Your rizq could be hasana. Many other things could be hasana. But hasana also could be that you don't have children. There are people Allah has decided them, they will not have children in this world, but he will give them in akhirah. That is hasana. Wa fil akhirati hasana. How many times we have seen people who have been given children and children are causing trouble to them until they blame, why did I get this particular boy or this particular girl? Nabiullah Nuh, messenger of Allah, was tested. Nabi of Allah. What about you and me? And that's why we need to have that open-mindedness when we enter into the institution of marriage. Not getting children should not be a challenge. You cannot have children. You need to go to adoption. And inshallah, we'll discuss about this particular issue. What are the issues in terms of Islamic law and Islamic jurisprudence when it comes to the issue of adoption? So these challenges, my dear brothers and sisters, we need to make sure we look at them closely in order for us to overcome them. I repeat again, the Holy Prophet saying in the Hadith, look for faith, but not only faith. He has said also, go for akhlaq. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. He says, إِذَا أَتَاكُمْ, if comes to you, he comes to you, man tardawna khuluqahu wa dinahu fazawiju. Person who you are happy with his faith, you are happy with his akhlaq, marry your children to this individual. What are the two things? akhlaq, morality, as well as faith, deen, religion. He says, if you don't do that, there will be problems. We need to go for these two things. When we marry, let us have aims and objectives, but one of those, we marry the ones who have faith and akhlaq, because by going to those two things, we'll get blessings, insha'Allah ta'ala. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all those who are married, insha'Allah ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless them with many blessings, ya Rabbal Alameen. Increase their sustenance, increase their barakat, increase their hasanat. Ya Allah, bestow upon them children who will be the righteous children, the servants of Imam of our time, Al-Hujjah ibn al-Hasan al-Mahdi, ajalallahu faraj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove obstacles in our marriages. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the hasad in our marriages. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove the challenges which sometimes we get from our children, ya Rabbal Alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us, inshallah, rizqan hasanan wasi'an halalan, ya Rabbal Alameen. Bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Khair, inshallah. After finishing, I think we have a few minutes for Q&A. Sahih. Inshallah, khair. It could be on this particular subject or general question and answer. Please feel free to ask. Yes, brother Abu. Bismillah. Yes. Yeah, we have, for example, Maasai, the tribe of Maasai in Africa. When you go to get married, or someone wants to get married from them, actually, they give their dowry is cow. They give you cows. They don't give money. Come, take cows. Yeah. And actually, there was one European lady, I don't know, from Sweden or Holland. She went there to get married and they said, we need to pay cows, so not, we don't know how can we ship them. Yeah, maybe Switzerland. Yeah, so they say, come, take this, the cows. But so not only that, we have girls, yeah, who say we have to pay the mahar. Mahar is an agreement. Mahar is something which you agree between the both parties. If they say, no, we don't want money, we want something, but we have to establish that, we have to make sure Islam has said mahar is part and parcel of the nikah process. In order for nikah to happen, if I recite the act of nikah, I will have to say that you have been married, or Mr. So is marrying you according to the dowry. We have to mention dowry and any other conditions. Now, of course, the permission of the wali. So now, once you mention the dowry has to be paid. So if she says, no, we pay the dowry, you say, okay, you pay me, then I'll pay back to you. But it has to be mentioned there. Without mentioning the dowry, there is mushkila in that particular act. Now, wallah. Yes, please. Mm-hmm. No. Yes, mahar is given by the husband-to-be or the father of the husband, the family or whoever. So the man's side is the side which is giving mahar, and the woman, they accept the mahar. Now. Exactly. There is no minimum requirement. We said it could be £1, it could be 10,000, it could be 100,000, it could be 1 million. But we were discussing about the hadith of the Holy Prophet where he says, "Khayru sadaqi aysaruhu." The best mahar is the one which is little. Don't make it too much until it causes trouble. Yeah. So that's why we mentioned 786, 1110, 114, these numbers. Now. Yeah. Any other question? If not, on the topic, yes, brother. Yeah, water should not, what if someone, the question is someone performs wudu and either gargling, let me add the word, or you put in the nose and the water goes inside. You feel it, it has gone. If you did intentionally, the sawm is batil. If you did it intentionally, or you know, if I do this, there is a big chance that I will cause the water to go inside my body. So that fasting is broken, is void. You have to pay back that. But if you know, no, there's no any problem. Accidentally, it happened. Accidentally, your fasting is okay. No problem at all. Continue with your fasting. There's no any paying anything. Your fasting is fine. Yeah. So here, what we'll look is intention. It's just the issue of intention. Now, yes, okay. Yes. Yeah, sure. Yeah, if you swallow water unintentionally, accidentally, it doesn't break your fast. If you know you do it intentionally, definitely it breaks your fast and you have to pay back that day. Now, khair, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of us, inshallah. Bi barakati salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Amin. Once again, let us recite Suratul Mubarakatul Fatiha for Marhumin and Marhumin of all those brothers and sisters who they have prepared the iftar and they have asked us to pray for their Marhumin. Surat Marhumin, Suratul Mubarakatul Fatiha. But before that, Salat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allah salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم حقا صراط بسم الله